Tasty Cake is proud to bring you the 1981 Phillies highlight film, Tasty Cake, the bakers of quality cakes, pies, and cookies. It was a time of unrestrained joy, an emotional outpouring of affection between a city and its conquering hero. The echoes and images will live on forever.
The parade and the reception that we got by the city of Philadelphia was an awesome sight.
You know, a lot of people dream about things that never come through. This was something that I dreamt about and it came true. And that feeling at that exact moment is something I'll never forget.
I'm not too concerned about everybody trying to knock us off. They certainly did that last year and have done it in the past years. It's just a matter of how strong we're going to be.
Having won the World Series this year, we now have that feeling and we know what it's like, and we certainly want to hang on to it as long as we can.
Every baseball player that puts a uniform on wants to have a World Series ring. I guess once you get that first one, that's what we're here for now, is to try and get that second one.
The 1981 season is the Phillies' search for an encore. It's a tough act to follow, but the defending champions relish the challenge and get set to take it from the top. After the rejoicing comes the reflecting on the magnitude of the Phillies' achievement, their first championship in 98 years. And then, of course, comes Clearwater, Florida, as the quest begins anew. The hope is that the second title won't be quite as long in coming as was the first. The brain trust must fight the dangers of complacency, and the Phillies' pot of Paul Owens decrees that some new faces will be practicing what he preaches. The bull is gone, and into the left field ring steps Gary Matthews, a hard-fought acquisition from Atlanta, whose aggressive style and versatility increase the options of manager Dallas Green. But even on a team bursting with talent like the Phillies, there's only one way to stay in front. Bodies going north to Philadelphia include six players who weren't on the World Series squad, but all of those in red and white are in for a red carpet greeting. The 11th grand opening of Veterans Stadium features some notable additions to the traditional festivities. The welcome home party draws salutations and congratulations, which remind all that the Phillies are baseball's king, at least until somebody unseats them. But there's always someone lurking behind you when you're lined up on top. The spoils of success are tough to hang on to, but if you got it, flaunt it. There's a nice, comfortable ring to the sound of World Champion Phillies. This spectacular tribute gives proof that the Phillies championship flag is still there. Everywhere there are signposts of past glories, but the sounds of success are not easily recaptured, as any self-respecting maestro will tell you. Taking it from the top, the Phillies of 81 are trying to bring the house down again. The pieces of the Phillies orchestra are all virtuosos, and when they're on key, there's no better symphony in baseball. But above all, the pinstripe players have a remarkable knack for improvisation. Out on each performance, they leave their unmistakable signatures. Phillies' elegant soloists are right in step, building a crescendo of excitement right from the top. Backed by the boisterous music of more than 60,000 aficionados, the Phils open at home on a winning note and go on to sweep all six games of their first homestand. There's no place like it, as Steve Carlton would gladly attest. In 9 years here, Lefty has 100 Vet Stadium wins. And right from the start of 81, he approaches a slew of new milestones with his customary cool.
Memorable night here at Veterans Stadium. 60,000 plus in attendance. Here's the pitch on the way. Ground ball up the middle, could be two. 3-1, relay double play, it's all over.
It's career win number 250 for Steve Carlton. Then 2 weeks later, the unflappable Lefty needs just three strikeouts to reach the 3,000 mark.
Swing and a miss, he struck him out. Comes right out of the chute and strikes out Tim Raines. Oh, see you later, there's number two. Here it comes again, the pitch to Wop. He struck him out, there it is!
With dramatic impatience, Carlton strikes out the first three Expos to become the first left-hander and sixth pitcher to reach the 3,000 strikeout plateau. Now, Phillies fans are wondering if the reticent lefty will make more history by granting a rare post-game interview.
In your first year here in 1972, I don't think I've ever seen since then a crowd respond to you like they did tonight when you struck out 3,000.
Yeah, they were wonderful tonight. They like to see people achieve different goals, and they're right there plugging with you, and you're always happy to have a nice crowd behind you like this.
Meanwhile, there's another smoking Philly who's hot in pursuit of a lifelong goal. The incomparable Pete Rose begins a relentless chase on the first pitch of the season. The first hit of the season brings Rose to within 72 of Stan Musial's National League hit record. Rose celebrates his 40th birthday by getting 13 hits in his first six games. And he proves there's still a lot of that little boy spirit left in him. Rose moves into second place on the all-time singles list, then hammers another record. Now there's no one between him and the man. And Stan Musial surfaces to witness Rose's quest for the magic number. June 10th, Vet Stadium, facing Nolan Ryan. Rose needs just one hit to tie the mark.
Was hit well. Here comes the center fielder, Scott. Cannot make the play. Base hit for Pete Rose. Oh, what a way to start this night. Sinking line drive for Rose, and he ties Stan Musial.
More than 57,000 have come to be a part of history, and now that Pete's pulled alongside the man, it's time to pull ahead. There'll be three more chances for Pete to do it, but the opposition is formidable. Rose's three strikeouts complete a most unlikely chapter, but the Phillies would still like to steal a page from their comeback book.
Second fielder, Gary Maddox.
Trailing 4-2 in the eighth. Maddox's blast caps a five-run rally, which salvages the evening for the Phillies. As it turns out, it'll be their last win in 2 months, where a player's strike calls a halt to the season just 2 days later. The Phillies, who lead the National League East Division, are rewarded with a first-half championship and an automatic berth in postseason play. Then in early August, the familiar sights and sounds begin to filter into Veterans Stadium.
Come on, reverse it!
Pete Rose rounds his ageless body into shape to resume his historic chase, while Phillies fans gaze into the past to honor a baseball immortal.
Ladies and gentlemen, St. Louis Cardinal Hall of Famer, Stan Musial.
In was 18 years ago that the man stepped up against Cincinnati for his last big league at-bat. Ironically, Pete Rose was the Reds' second baseman on that fateful day. These moments that bind together the generations. In his fifth at bat of the second season, Pete Rose moves up to the top of the National League's hit list. More than 60,000 at the Met now have a collectible ticket stub, but Rose is already dreaming of collecting another distant goal. Baseball's epical record of 4,191 hits. After Musial graciously relinquishes his record, Rose conducts a post-game seminar on how to keep history in perspective.
If I may have your attention, please, we'll get started.
Tell the president I'll be waiting in a minute.
Mr. Rose?
Yes, sir.
Mr. President's on. Go ahead, please.
Hello? Yes, sir.
Hello, Mr. Rose. One moment, please.
Hello?
One moment, sir.
Maybe the operators went on strike. Good thing you're in a missile on the way.
Mr. Rose, one moment, please.
Okay. I waited 19 years. I can wait another minute or so. I got a recording here, I think. Yes.
If you hang up this phone, I'll call you right back.
Okay. Yes.
Who's speaking, please?
Pete Rose.
One moment, sir.
Larry, I'll give you my home number. What's that? Just a moment, please.
Hello.
Hello.
Pete Rose?
Yes, sir.
Listen, this is Ronald Reagan.
How you doing?
Well, I don't know. I'll tell you, I've had as much trouble getting this line, or a lot. I think I had to wait longer than you did to to break the record.
Well, we were going to give you five more minutes, and that was it.
I just wanted, we've been having some trouble here getting through, and I just wanted to call and congratulate you. I know how you must feel, and I think it's great.
Well, thank you very much, and I appreciate it, and I know that you're a baseball fan, and we appreciate you taking time out to call us here in Philadelphia. I know all the fans appreciate it, and Pete Rose II appreciate it too.
Well, I can tell you that after the long dry spell here, waiting for the season to get underway, this is you've really brought it in style.
Well, thank you very much. You play a good football player too.
Well, thank you. Okay.
Okay.
Well,
nice talking to you.
Congratulations again.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Bye bye.
Bye.
Even the Gipper's impressed with how well Rose stands up under the lights. But whether it's in the Oval Office or on the diamond, a man can only go as far as the spirit moves him. Pete Rose hopes to rekindle the Phillies' championship spirit in the second half. But even when it seems things are heading in the right direction, somehow the cause gets lost along the way. When Rose is ruled out, a bellowing manager leads an inquisition. Mistakes are tough to swallow, and gradually it becomes clear that something's been deleted from the Phillies' efforts.
As we roll along, as the season got longer, the second half of the season got longer, we just didn't have the same intensity and drive that we did have at the beginning of the year. During the strike, I don't know what happened, but we just seemed to lose that intensity, and as a result, we didn't play very good baseball.
The Phillies play themselves into every nightmare imaginable and lose more often than not in the second half. So a word to the wise seems in order for those who play the fool.
Okay, so you're heartbroken. You sit around hoping, crying, crying.
well before you do anything rash. Dig this. Everybody plays the fool sometimes. There's no exception to the rule. Listen, baby, it may be factual, may be cruel.
No one is immune from the Phillies' second-half folly, not even the main ingredient of their offense. But even through the stumbles of the late summer, Mike Schmidt performs regally and defends the honor of the Phillies' crowd. During the strike, the reigning National League MVP adopts a think-small approach, focusing on the little things and just letting the big hits fall where they may. The All-Star Game in Cleveland is a perfect forum for the Big Bang Theory of philosopher Schmidt. Schmidt's two-run homer is his first in All-Star competition, and it's a dramatic game-winner for the National League. In the vacation month of August, Betts Stadium does a huge tourist trade because the package includes the game's top draw, Mike Schmidt. On his way to a third straight slugging title, Schmidt pushes his average over 300, where it will finish for the first time in his nine-year career. Once a prime target of the Philly Boo Birds, Schmidt is now the toast of the town, and his introspective ways no longer get in the way of his instincts. On August 14th, another milestone against Mike Scott. Schmidt blasts one into the blue sky over Shea. And it's career home run number 300. The Phillies' all-time home run king is named Player of the Month in August and then steps aside for a September show you wouldn't believe. It's a performance that comes out of left field where Gary Matthews is finally feeling at home in pinstripes. Matthews' defensive style would best be described as dauntless. Such left field acrobatics are foreign to Phillies fans, who are won over by the unconquerable spirit of this man they call a flat-out gamer.
Swing a long drive! Might be the ball game! Way, way back! Out of here! Gary Matthews has won the ball game!
With a league-leading 7 homers and 31 RBIs, Matthews ain't misbehaving in September. The exemplary conduct of the young Phillies also draws attention. Lonnie Smith equals the Major League's best-hitting streak by getting at least one safety in the last 23 games. But while Smith is stealing extra bases, another speedy young center fielder, Bob Dernier, looks like he's ready for a shot at a Phil's starting spot. After swiping Smith's minor league stolen base record, Dernier joins the Phillies' top pinch hitter, Dick Davis, as a part-time outfielder. Davis bats 337 and gives Phillies fans a new name to remember. Just in case they forget, there's another Davis for reinforcement. Hard-throwing Mark Davis, who's moving in the right direction. Davis remains a promising question mark, but the Phillies' more predictable left-hander provides an answer. On September 21st, Steve Carlton bears down on yet another milestone.
He got him. I'm Gray Dawson, and it was a slider, and Carlton has become the all-time greatest strikeout pitcher in National League history. 3,117, and the whole team is coming out to congratulate Steve Carlton.
Even the Expos fans applaud Carlton, but they're hoping to get another crack at him as the Expos battle the Cardinals for the right to meet the Phillies in the playoffs. On September 24th, Philly batters conduct a Redbird massacre, scoring 11 runs in one inning. The Phils bust out for 8 straight hits, the big league's longest hit streak in 51 years. The 81 Phillies wind up leading the National League in batting average and runs scored. With the start of the playoffs approaching, it's time to unleash the big guns.
Oh, my goodness! Mike Schmidt, a drive! There! Phillies win the ball game on Mike Schmidt's pinch hit three-run homer number 30.
On the last weekend of the regular season, Schmidt wraps up the home run and RBI crowns, and the Phillies prepare for the defense of their World Series title. The Montreal Expos, having outlasted the Cardinals, are the first contenders to the throne, and their wintry wonderland has the Phils feeling frigid in the first two games of this best-of-five playoff. Steve Carlton's presence in the opener provides little shelter as the Expos batter around the Phillies' ace right from the start. Three early Expo runs stand up for Montreal's first postseason win, and the Expos' bid for a sweep at home seems safe for now. The Phillies are learning it's lonely at the top, and with their top pitcher already knocked off, the pressure falls on Dick Ruthven, the Phils' second winningest pitcher. Once again, an early uprising proves decisive for the Expos. The home team takes two by identical scores of 3-1, giving rise to a rash of optimism, Maple Leaf style. Once south of the border, though, the series takes on a new look. Everywhere, Phillies fans remind their heroes of what's expected, and Manny Trio gets the stymied attack untracked. Phillies take their first lead of the series and pour it on from there. It's a 6-2 win for the defending champs, and now they're talking title again in Philly. Game four is a reviewer's delight, a tense back and forth drama which stands tied at four when Gary Matthews bats in the sixth. First postseason homer of Matthews' nine-year career puts the Phillies back on top. The persistent Expos, though, come right back to tie, and Tug McGraw enters the deadlocked extra-inning affair. Stage is now set for pinch hitter George Vukovic leading off the bottom of the 10th.
Vukovic slams one deep right field. It's all over! George Vukovic, a pinch hit home run, and we're going to game five!
It's the kind of timely heroics which made the Phillies world champs in 1980. And now it seems the Phils are finally ready to descend from their lofty perch and deliver a fitting encore. The climactic fifth game is a Carlton-Rogers rematch, and the Expo hurler performs way beyond the call of duty. Foiling the Phils time and time again, Rogers also contributes a two-run single, and the end is near. Trio lines to a leaping Warren Cromarty, and the Montreal Expos win their first division title in the team's 13-year history. The Phillies' dream comes to an abrupt halt, even after things seem to be falling in place. The plucky Expos just plain went out and whipped the Phillies' stopper.
They beat Carlton twice. Any team can beat Carlton twice within the span of five days deserves to win. I don't care what anybody says.
If you got a five-game series with the Phillies and you're going to beat Carlton twice, we're not going to beat you. It's just that simple.
Explaining the Phillies' fall from power in 81 is a bit more complex. In that championship year, there was always someone around to pick up the pieces. But in baseball's changing wheels of fortune, the 1981 Phillies too often let the big plays slip away. Phillies' search for better fortune assumed a frenetic pace after the season's finale. Manager Dallas Green announced he was heading for the front office of the Chicago Cubs. While the Phillies' owner, Rudy Carpenter, reluctantly ended a 38-year family tradition by selling his beloved ball club. Carpenter's hurt was soothed somewhat by his affection for the buyer, Bill Giles, a longtime member of the Phillies family for whom it was a dream come true.
Set a goal when I was 15 years old to tried and operate and run a major league club, and I'm elated. I'm kind of a goal-oriented guy, always have been. In 1991, I want the Philadelphia Phillies to be declared the team of the decade.
Keeping it all in the family, Paul Owens named former Philly Pat Corrales the new skipper.
I started with Philadelphia, and it's just great to be back here in Philly, and we have a lot of work ahead of us, and we're going to try and put it together and be ready for spring training.
The Phillies' preparation for 82 began with a trade of Lonnie Smith for Bo Diaz, Cleveland's all-star catcher. Then they acquired veteran pitcher Mike Kruko, won 9 games with the Cubs during the shortened 81 season. While the wheels kept spinning, there was a late autumn pause to pay further homage to Mike Schmidt, named the National League's MVP for the second straight year.
Here's a ball well hit to deep left field. Grand slam home run!
When the pyrotechnics resume in the spring of 82, the Phillies will once again be taking it from the top. It's the start of a new era, one that promises to bring that championship feeling back to Philadelphia. The 1981 Phillies highlight film has been brought to you by Tasty Cake. Nobody bakes a cake as tasty as Tasty Cake.